Well, good morning. Nice to see you all here today. It's a beautiful day to gather together and worship the Lord. We're glad you're with us today, whether in person or online. It's just a good day to gather and worship the Lord. I do got some announcements to go over with you this morning. It is a new month already, or we're moving into that new month from next week, October already. So there's a newsletter this morning, so I encourage you to read through that newsletter. And lots of events coming up for into the fall and even into early winter already mentioned in that newsletter, so just keep up to date with that. As you can see, the shoe boxes are already out in the foyer for Operation Christmas Child. We're handing them out. They'll come back around Thanksgiving time, I believe, and you can start grabbing them and start filling them up for that program. It's a wonderful program we get involved with. We've had some funerals, so be praying for them families that have been there. But because of that, you guys have blessed us with lots of dishes. So there's plenty of dishes in the back, all washed and cleaned up with your name on them. If you want to take a walk back there and see if you got one back there, go ahead and grab up your dish. There's lots of things out there in the foyer on the tables for sign-ups and events, on the bulletin boards, on the screens. You can pay attention to all that stuff. But on that backup sign-up table back there, there is something for signing up for fellowship snack time. All them snacks back there are typically provided by you guys. So if you want to be involved with that, there's a sign-up sheet back there. You can put your name down, a date, and they'll kind of know who's bringing what when. So that's on the table. That's new. So you can look out for that. Celebrate Recovery tonight. As normal, all is welcome to be a part of that. Grief Share on Tuesday night. You can talk to Sherry. They're back in their season now with their study guides and their material. So that's been going and going strong for Grief Share. Wednesday morning Bible study. We've been doing a study of John with Al's been putting that on Wednesday mornings at 9:30 a.m. That's been a good Bible study. I encourage you to get involved with that. Awana's going strong. Wednesday evening service is joining again. Youth group, of course. Wednesdays are a full day. So see all the things that are going on with that. October 3rd is Students Bring Your Bible to School Day. We still have that freedom and that privilege for our children to bring their Bibles to school today. Share what that Bible. Charge. I can get loud enough so you can hear me. I know that, but I want the friends online to hear too. So we can still bring our Bibles to school for our children. So bring your Bibles to school day, October 3rd. There's a wedding coming up here on the 5th for Carly and Andrew. That'll be taking place here. Women's meeting October 12th already coming up. And then Pastor Kenny from the Verndale Area Christian Academy will be coming to share on the 20th. And then there's some other announcements down there at the bottom. Feel free to read through them. We're still taking donations of Bibles if you're interested, or if you got some Bibles you want to donate. There's a bin in the foyer in the back there. And then the Gideons got this Bible drive going on too, so be praying for them as they reach out and plan on giving away tens of thousands of Bibles. So be praying for the Gideons and that Bible drive that they got going on. You can see the prayer focus, lots of names on there, always changing, and just people calling in and asking and seeking prayer. We're so grateful for that, and we just want to be praying for them as they call in and you see them names on there. So let's just seek the Lord in prayer this morning as we invite him into our service and everything that we do here today. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day, Lord, that we can come into this building, this beautiful building that you provided us, Lord, to worship you, to come into your presence this morning, Lord, and seek you. Lord, that's our desire this morning. Be with our worship team as we sing songs and praise to you this morning. Be with our pastor. Fill him with your spirit, Lord, to proclaim what is on his heart today, Lord, to glorify you and to change us, to change our hearts, to seek you and follow you and do your will, Lord. We ask for your hand in that. We pray for the Sunday schools that will gather here today, the nursery care, even our snack and fellowship time, Lord. May you be glorified in it all. Lord, we pray for our community, the other churches in our region, in our area, that are gathering today and doing the same thing we are, glorifying your holy name. And Lord, that we would just proclaim who Jesus is all over our region and area. Lord, may you be glorified on this beautiful Sunday morning. We pray for our ministries, Verndale Area Christian Academy, like we mentioned, Minnesota Adult and Teen Challenge, NCBI Radio, and all the other laps that we can reach out and we can come together and sign up and pray on Tuesday mornings, Lord, to storm the gates of heaven to stop abortion, Lord. Give us the ability to do that, Lord, and may your hand move in it all. We pray for our local ministries that we are involved with. Lord, just be with us here today. Move in powerful ways as you have been. We just are excited to come into your presence this morning. We love you, Lord. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to welcome forward our worship team this morning. If you want to just welcome and say hello to those sitting around you.
A hymn called Sweet Hour of Prayer.
Jesus.
The next song we're singing is Proof of Your Love. Revelation 4, starting at around verse 8, says, "And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within, and day and night they never cease to say, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.' And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne, and they worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, 'Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created.'" The last song we're going to sing together this morning is called "Endless Praise," and it gives that picture of eternity with the King.
I can't wait for eternity. Join the song they're already singing. Holy, holy, holy are you. Just to bow down before your throne, see your face and cry out, because you're holy, holy, holy are you, Lord.
prayer, you may be seated or you may remain standing or you can kneel, whatever you want to do. But I want us to quiet our hearts and just invite the Lord's presence here with us this morning. Maybe some of these words, little ones, if you're going to children's church, little ones, you're dismissed. And maybe it's some words that we've just sung, or maybe something else is on your mind this morning. Maybe some heaviness from the week, maybe the schedule that lie ahead. But I just want to invite us to go to the Lord, just you and the Lord for a few minutes, and invite Him, invite His presence here with us this morning. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we have come to worship you and you know, Lord, and I know that there's probably a lot of things on our minds, but I pray that we would lay them down and avail our minds, our hearts, our very soul to listening to your Spirit. We invite your presence, O God. Holy Spirit, come. Touch hearts. Touch lives. Get our attention. Save, forgive, redeem us, O God. I pray this morning, Father, as we have gathered, and perhaps some are watching online, I pray that we can just focus on you. I know we got a lot on our minds. I know we got a lot on our agendas. I know there's heaviness. I know there's brokenness. But God, I pray that you would help us just focus on you. Lord Jesus, our nation needs you. We've sung about Jesus. Father, thank you for sending Jesus. Our nation needs Jesus. The church needs a new bathing of your Holy Spirit. We need a revival of our hearts. May it begin with us. Spirit of God, move in us today. In the Sunday school classes, in the children's church, but in this sanctuary, move amongst us, Spirit of God, I pray. And where people are gathering in churches all over our region and our nation, and really the Western Hemisphere, God, I pray that the name of Jesus would be lifted up, that you would be glorified, lives would be redeemed, changed, transformed, people set free, healed, whatever you see fit. Father, we pray that you would be glorified. And so as we have come here this morning, we have come for one reason. That is to worship you. And so clear our minds of everything else and help us as we continue our worship of you to focus on you and worship you in spirit and in truth. Guide us, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Kristen, I'm going to invite you to pop that screen up. I'm going to invite everybody else to grab a Bible. We're not going to look at the big screen. And the reason we're not is not because I want to keep something secret from you. I want you to, if you've got your Bible, wonderful. If you don't happen to have one, there's probably one under the chair somewhere in front of you. It's a New King James Version. But it's going to be the same version that I referred to this morning. And so I want us to look at the scripture ourselves. And let me say this, I've said this a lot of times. If you don't have a Bible, we do have one. We'd love to give it to you. We want you to have one. We want you to spend time in the Word of God. And so today I want you to either open up your Bible or grab the one that is in under a seat in front of you so you can follow along. And if you want to, you can turn to Luke 7. I'm going to refer to that. We were there a little bit last week. Or if you want to, you can turn to John 14. That's where we're going to get to this morning. But I want you to see it from the pages of Scripture today. But before we look at Scripture, let me take a step back. For all of us here, and for those of you online, thank you for listening. Thank you for joining us. But I want to take a step back and just give us some really, really basic stuff for a moment about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I know that for some this will be redundant, some you might even be bored, I hope not, but I just want you to bear with me for a couple of minutes while I attempt to bring the last 2 weeks of topics and today all together. So to revisit just briefly, 2 weeks ago I shared from Mark chapter 5, those of you that are here, you recall the story of how Jesus crossed the sea, he encountered the demon-possessed man, he had a legion of demons in him, and when this man encountered Jesus, he was radically changed. Those of you that were here, remember, or those of you that know the story, probably know this. When we really encounter Jesus, he will change you. Amen? And of course, in that story, former demon-possessed man wanted to follow Jesus, and Jesus gave him a very simple task that I challenged us with 2 weeks ago. Go home and tell your family and friends the good things that God has done for you. That's what he tasked him with. Go home and tell your friends and your family the good things that God has done for you. Because when you have encountered Jesus, he will change you. And we've got a story to tell. When we encounter Jesus, and I mean soul to soul, spirit to spirit, when we encounter Jesus, he will not only change you, he will give you a new capacity and a new capability to love. Amen? This is what we saw last week when we looked at Luke chapter 7 and discussed the scene where Jesus was invited by Simon the Pharisee into his home. But it was this woman that the Pharisee Simon referred to her as this sinner. It was this woman who loved Jesus to the point of washing his feet with her tears and drying them with her hair. So that's what we looked at the last couple of weeks. Now, when I talk about love, which I'm going to talk about loving Jesus today, I'm not talking about manufacturing some kind of artificial love that I exhibit or display once a week on Sundays, or I try to manufacture or produce on my own. I'm not talking about that. I am talking about a love that is more evident because I have encountered Jesus. Not something I'm trying to produce, something I'm trying to work my way to heaven, but because I have encountered Jesus, I have a new capacity to love. And so I want us to think about how, as the title says in your bulletins, how do we love Jesus? The basics of the gospel. Listen to me, friends, before I jump into some scripture. When I repent of sin, and that is a prerequisite because the Bible says, and you know it and I know it, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so we need to come to this point of repentance. I need to recognize I am a sinner who needs a Savior. And we may see, I'm not like the sinning woman. I'm not like the demon-possessed. But we all have been in the category of sin. And Jesus' first message in the first chapter of Mark was, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. And so we must recognize within the gospel equation is an opportunity, a reality that God will forgive us of our sins because of what was accomplished on the cross, because of Christ. But we must recognize I need to repent. And repentant means turning away from who I used to be outside of Christ. That's part of the gospel equation. So, when I repent of sin and receive Christ as Lord and Savior of my life and commit to follow Him, everything changes. Amen? Stay with me, friends. I'll get to the point in a minute. Everything changes. My eternal destination from the broad road that leads to hell changes to the narrow gate that leads to light. Everything changes. My ability to love changes. My capacity to love changes. So when I talk about loving unto obedience today, it's not loving unto obedience to become God's child or get to heaven. It is loving unto obedience because I am new in Christ. Are you still with me? Because I am new in Jesus. I don't want anybody to be confused about salvation by faith in Jesus and the results of that salvation versus I'm trying to work my way to heaven with good works. I don't want us to be confused about that. Luke chapter 7, we saw this. I'm just going to refer to a minute before I go to John 14. If you got your Bibles, I'm Luke 7, again, verse 41. We saw this last week. Jesus is in the house of Simon the Pharisee. Simon the Pharisee invited him, but he did nothing for him to show any love. The woman did. The woman wept at the feet of Jesus, so much so that her tears fell on his feet, and she wiped his feet with her hair. And Simon, you remember the story, was sensing in his heart and saying probably in his spirit, maybe even out loud, if he was really a prophet talking about Jesus, he would know what kind of person that woman is. And that's where we come to this little story. I said it last week. I'll reiterate it to set the stage today. Jesus said this, Simon, I'm going to tell you a little something. A certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more? That's the question he puts to Simon. Which is going to love him more? The one with the great debt, like this lady, on her hands and knees, washing his feet with her tears, or somebody with maybe not the background she had? Who's going to love him more? Simon said, the one, I suppose, for whom he canceled the larger debt. And Jesus said to Simon, you have judged rightly. And turning to the woman, he said, Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but he who is forgiven little loves little. You see, friends, Simon could represent many church folks today, I fear, saying that we love God, but our hearts and actions, like Simon's, say otherwise. Yes, Simon invited Jesus to lunch, but it was the woman that Simon called the sinner who loved much and showed that she loved much. Simon did not. That brings me to the question again, to follow up last week's scripture and question, how much do we love Jesus? How much do we love him? Do we love like Simon? Or do we love like the woman? And now to build on that for just the few minutes that I have left, how do we love Jesus? John 14. I'm going to read a few verses starting at verse 15. How do we love Jesus? We can say we do all day long, friends. But do we love him like Simon, or do we love him like the woman? How do we love Jesus? I'm not talking about for an hour on Sunday morning. I'm talking Sunday afternoon through Saturday night. How do we love Jesus? Here's what he said. Jesus is speaking to the disciples. If you know the setting, John 14 is part of that long conversation that John records for us, 13, 14, 15, 16, that long conversation he's having with the disciples at the Last Supper before they go to the Garden of Gethsemane. And part of that conversation he challenges them with, as he challenges us, verse 15, John 14, if you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, when we surrender our life to Christ, the Holy Spirit will take up residence in us, friends, and it takes us from the broad road because of our faith, because of the grace of God. The Spirit comes in, and we move from that broad road that leads us to hell to the narrow road that leads us to life. And something happens within us. We've got this new capacity to love, and we have this new capacity to be obedient to the commands of God. And Jesus said, do you really love me? Then keep my commandments. Verse 21. There's more in there, but and it's very good stuff. But my time is running out, so I need to move on. Verse 21. Jesus says to them again, and he says to us, he who has my commandments and keeps them It is He who loves me. Friends, that's why I challenge us to read the book. How are we going to know the will of God if we don't know what's in the Word of God? That's why I ask us to read the book. How am I going to obey the commandments of Jesus if I don't read it? And we can't know the commandments if we don't spend any time in the Word. And Jesus says, he that understands and knows these commandments and keeps them, that's the person that loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Friends, hear me now. When you encounter Jesus, he will change you. Okay, we established that 2 weeks ago. And if we haven't been changed, if our ability and our capacity to love him isn't changed, then we better go back to Jesus. And we better cry out to him. And we better invite him to take control of our lives. We better surrender to him. We need to allow the Spirit to come in. Jesus said, whoever asks God for the Spirit, he will give it to him. And if we haven't got that new capacity to love differently than we used to, we need to go back to Jesus. And if we have not got a new capacity to be obedient to the Word of God, we better go back to Jesus. Because he said it will only be evident in your lives that you have Christ in your life if we are obedient to what he says. I know we don't like the word obey. I get it. We look at the stop sign and we think, well, that's just a suggestion. I know it's true because I got a window that looks at the stoplights. Well, that's just a suggestion. We see 55 mile an hour, well, that's just a suggestion. I get it. We don't like the word obey. Children, there's not so many children in here, but the Bible says obey your parents. We say, yeah, our parents are out of touch. They don't understand me. We look at the commands of God, we look at Scripture as suggestions. Like we look at the 55 mile an hour speed limit. When God calls us to sexual purity and he says that he has developed this beautiful thing called sexual intimacy, but he's given that to the human race in the confines of a man and a woman in marriage, that's not a suggestion. But we look at what his word says anymore, well, that's just a suggestion, or that's for some older people, or that's from some starchy old preacher like Jim. No, he said, if you love me, you'll obey these things. That's what he said. And if we look at Romans chapter 1, and we look at Galatians chapter 5, we see all these things that he lists. And he talks about lying, and he talks about coveting, and he talks about drunkenness, and he talks about backstabbing and backbiting, and he talks about stirring up strife amongst the brethren. And all of this stuff, he says, people of God, don't go there. So he's given us his instruction. Do you really love me? Then start obeying my commandments. That's what he said. But we look at his word as suggestions. Just like the stop sign. Well, I'll slow down a little bit, but I'm just going to go. Nobody's coming. We look at his word the same way. He who has my commandments and keeps them, that's the person, he said, that loves me. Do we love him unto obedience? Or do we love him like Simon? Do we love him like the woman that was on her face before him, washing his feet with her tears? How do I love Jesus? If you love me, he said, then keep my commandments. Are you hearing me, friends? These aren't suggestions. And if I live Sunday afternoon through Saturday night like I want to live, and maybe I'll do what the Bible says or what Jim says on Sunday morning for an hour, we don't love him. If you love me, then keep my commandments. He knew that the disciples would have trouble with that. He knew we would. That's why he sent his Spirit. That's why John 14 and 15 talk about the Holy Spirit coming. You're not on your own. When you have been born of God, I've been born of God, you're not on your own. He's given us his Spirit to help us obey the commandments. The commandments that he's laid out for us in all of the New Testament and the Old. Verse 23, same chapter. Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Three times in a matter of a few verses, he's challenging the disciples. Do you really love me? Then be obedient to what I've told you. Friends, listen to me. I've told you this 100 times over the last 20 years. I'm not talking about working your way to heaven by keeping commands. I'm talking about keeping the commands of God because you have encountered Jesus and he has radically transformed you and me. There is a difference. I have surrendered my life to Christ. The Holy Spirit of God has taken up residence in me. Know you not? Paul said in Corinthians that your body is now the temple of the living God. The Holy Spirit of God has taken up residence in me. If I have encountered Jesus, and when and if I encounter Jesus, it's a brand new day. And one of the byproducts of encountering Jesus is a longing, a desire, if you will, to obey his commandments. That should be who we are. John 15, 14, he said it this way. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. I don't know about you, friends, but when I read John 14 and 15, it don't seem like rocket science to me. Are you with me this morning? This doesn't seem like rocket science. When Jesus makes a statement, if you love me, keep my commandments, I think that's fairly easy to understand. Are we perfect? Do we become robots? No, we still have freedom to choose. We have to choose to be obedient to him. But when we have the Holy Spirit of God living in us, we have a new ability to follow Jesus. And he said, if you love me, you will follow me that close. You will do what my word says versus what your flesh wants to do. That's what you've been doing outside of Christ. How do we love Jesus? When we look at what he said, we love him by being obedient to his word. I'm only going to be able to love the Lord when I get myself out of the way. That's why he said to his would-be disciples when he was here, you're going to follow me? You've got to deny yourself. I'm only going to be obedient to the Lord and love him to the point of getting myself out of the way and putting him first. And I'm only going to keep his commands like he said to us when I really love him first. If I just do my own thing, then I don't love him. Not the way he describes here. Because he said, if you love me, you'll keep my commands. I think he says the first thing in 1 John, don't he? Same thing in 1 John, don't he, Al? He's been teaching that on Wednesday mornings. Do you really love me, people of God? Or do you love yourself yet? Because if you love me, he said over and over, you'll keep my commands. Why do we find it so hard to obey? If you love me, keep my commands, he said. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, he said. Why do we still let idolatry climb into our lives? Why does sexual immorality run rampant in society today? Lying. Why does lying come so easy? Why is it so hard for us to obey? Maybe we haven't loved him like we should. Maybe we're still loving him like Simon. Why does pride get in our way? Why do we fight in the church amongst each other? Why do we stab each other in the back? Why do we envy? He lists all these things: unloving, unforgiving, disobedience to parent, hatred, drunkenness, sexual immorality, and a whole lot more. All of these he lists. Why do we find it so hard to be obedient? Maybe we don't love him first. Maybe he ain't first after all. Maybe I'm still first. Maybe that's why I got to do all the stuff yet. I don't know, friends. I just don't think this is rocket science. I just happen to think that if God was first, if Jesus was Lord for all of us, we would actually long to be obedient. I just happen to think that if Jesus were Lord, we would want to love him unto obedience. I don't think that's that difficult to understand. I realize, because I've been there, it's kind of hard to live out. That's why he sent his Spirit to help us with that. I'm just afraid that so oftentimes, even in the church, we're too much like Simon the Pharisee. We got a few words, but we got no substance. We say we love God, but we're like Simon. We got nothing for proof. Because Sunday afternoon through Saturday night, it's just living for me. I'm not living like he's first. I'm not living like he's my Lord. And maybe that's where we got to start. Maybe we got to start on our knees before him and ask for forgiveness and say, Lord, I've been living for myself for a long time. It's time I want to live for you. And with your Spirit's help, I really do want to live for you unto obedience. When Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commands to the disciples that night, he wasn't offering up multiple choice. And so I asked Jim, I asked myself, do I love him unto obedience? Do I? Do you? Do we love him or don't we? Because he said, if you do, you'll obey my commands. You'll do what I said. Simon didn't. And maybe too oftentimes, even in the churches in America, we don't either. Oh, we love him when I do for a while on Sunday morning, but the rest of the week, that's mine. Maybe we got the attitude of Simon. I'm going to quit. Ladies, it's time. It's time, and so I'm going to quit. I would like to challenge us a little bit more, but I just want to say this. If there's no evidence, friends, in your life or mine, if there's no evidence of our love for Jesus Sunday afternoon through Saturday, then we better get back to Jesus. We better get back to Him by faith and surrender. Repent, receive Him as Lord, and surrender our life to Him. Because He said, if you love me, then you'll keep my commands. And if nobody can see the love of God in my life or yours, then we better get back to Jesus. We better get back to Him by faith and surrender. This song is about loving Jesus. And while we're singing this song, if you want to pray about something, you want to come to the altar and kneel, you feel free to do that. If you want one of us to pray with you, we'll do that. Casey and I can pray with you. Dale and Carl are here. They can pray with you. There's other pastors here that would probably love to pray with you. I'm not talking about, okay, now I got to do this, I got to do that, because Jim said so. I'm talking about, have I surrendered to Jesus to the point I want to obey Him? That's the difference. I want to. And Jesus said, there will be evidence in your life. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. You will be obedient to what I've said, what the Word of God says. How do we love Him, friends? How do we love Jesus? Let's stand and sing this song.
Oh,
Friends, I know it's after 10, but I want to say this once more. If you encounter Jesus in a real way, He will change you.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? And if I continue to go back to the well of sin week after week after week, we need to encounter Jesus again. Because Jesus is crystal clear. If we really love Him, we'll be obedient to Him. Now let me say this before I close in prayer. Because I want to give you opportunity to give God glory before you leave. Last Sunday, someone was here that encountered the power of Jesus. And I say that because for 40 years, this person has experienced a lot of physical pain in their body. 40 years worth of arthritis and other difficulties. And last week, he encountered Jesus. And this week, he's been in a place almost no pain for the first time in 40 years. Now, he may change you from pain, but he will change you from the bondage of sin. He will change you. And if you haven't been changed, if you're still going back to the old habits, then I'm encouraging you, I'm pleading with you, get alone with God today and cry out to Him and say, Jesus, take over. Forgive me. Come into my life and take over. Because when you really surrender, He will change you. And you don't want to go anymore to the well of sin. Because you want to be obedient to the living God. That's where we should be. With faith in Christ, being led by the Spirit. Surrender. Give it all to Jesus. And let Him change you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Your word is truth. Thank you for the stories that show us how you have radically changed people. You've rescued people from sickness, from death, but you've also rescued us from hell when we give our life to Christ. When we encounter Christ, you change us. You give us a new spirit. You transform us into a new creation. God, I pray that's the case for everyone here. But if it isn't, I pray that we'd call upon the name of Jesus today and repent and invite the Holy Spirit to help us be obedient to the teachings of Jesus. God, I pray that you would go with everyone here into this week changed because they have encountered Christ, filled with the Holy Ghost and longing to be obedient because we love Jesus. Go with each and every one, I pray. In the name of Jesus, amen.